from Virginia. Someone from Virginia is recognized. Not that anyone recognized you, Dave, but technically Mr. Meadows is up next, but I'll go to you and then we'll come back to Mr. Meadows.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and my two colleagues are letting me go prior to them because it's my birthday and my parents are out in Statuary Hall. And so I'm a professor. I see a lot of young people out there. It's great to see you. Raise your hand if you're young. Raise your hand if you feel young. All right, good. So we got a lot. I'm a professor for 20 years, so I used to torture you all in economics 101 classes. So I see you sitting here, so here you go again. I'm going to give you a little philosophical lecture. And the witnesses today were all just phenomenal. Mr. Carolla, in the last series of questions, said we got to learn to be good. And that right there sums it up. And I'm going to ask the college presidents how we ground our philosophical statements. That'll be my question, right? So they can give a cursory view of Western Civ in the 30 seconds I leave you at the end. But I have a famous painting in my office with Plato pointing up, right? What is the good? He thought it was up there in the realm of the forms. And Aristotle's pointing down. And no one has resolved that question philosophically in 2,400 years. There is no definition of the good. That's what makes it crucially important that we do the liberal arts education and allow all views to be heard from 2,400 years of human history. And on that note, I hope we all agree. My colleagues on the other side of the aisle have spoken about atrocities that have occurred in Western Civ. I totally agree with them. That's not what this is about today. But it's about teaching these first principles. Everyone's talking about shared values today. I'm not sure if there are any shared values today. The guy, if you want to read a good book, read Alistair McIntyre. He'll start off on the good, right? You probably heard of him. But his book is called Which Rationality, Whose Justice? Same question, right? Whose justice, which rationality, and what is the good? And we don't have answers to that right now, so your generation better get moving. The liberal arts, I started teaching about 20 years ago. We went from liberalism. I'm a 19th century liberal, right? They call me a right-wing knuckle-dragger in a newspaper, right? But I'm a classic. I believe in Adam Smith and James Madison, the author of the Constitution. And liberals, my liberal colleagues on the Democratic side of the aisle, always used to respect my view 20 years ago. That shifted in academia in the last 20 years. Now it's the hard left, and they're following a philosophy called deconstruction. They're ripping apart the foundations of the country. The Judeo-Christian tradition, the rule of law, and free markets are under attack by the left, not my Democrat friends I go to church with. That's a distinction. And if you ask them to ground their definition of the good or name a philosopher that undergirds their thinking, they can't do it. So make sure you young people ask your professors, when they're spouting off, say, name a philosopher. And if they can't do it, write about it in the student newspaper, because it's an embarrassment. And so I went to Princeton Seminary. The seminary voluntarily moved itself across the tracks because we don't believe in forcing religion on other people. That's the great debate, right? So we've had the Enlightenment Project. We tried to ground reality in human reason alone. Worked great in the sciences. But in the moral realm, it failed, right? Jefferson, Immanuel Kant was kind of the end of the Enlightenment Project. And the moral vision failed because they could not tell you why it is that human beings are worthy of dignity in the first place. But our shared values were delivered in the Declaration was fairly clear. We have inalienable rights that come from our Creator. Wow, there's a shocker. Ask your leftist professors if they believe in those shared values, those inalienable rights, right, that precede the existence of government, that come from our Creator. And boy, there you have it all, right? So that has been rejected by the left. In K-12 education, I'm sad to report the kids are not taught any system of ethics for the first 13 years of their education. And then in college, they're taught leftism. And so now we're left talking about free speech, one particular part of the First Amendment, and a narrow part, and we're being told by some people, leave it to the academic institutions. You gotta be kidding me. These are the first principles that ground and surround the space that universities inhabit, right? So the rule of law has to precede what educational entities do, and that's why we're here today talking about the law that will surround the space you all act in. And so I'll just give you another quiz. Here's the ethical schools that are taught in higher ed. Raise your hand if you're an Aristotelian. No, none of them. Right? Raise your hand if you're a follower of utilitarianism. Bentham, John Stuart Mill. Really? Good. Good for you. Okay, that's the harm principle. Ms. Strassen mentioned that. Raise your hand if you're a follower of Immanuel Kant, if you're a Kantian. So we got two people. Good. So those are the schools of thought you're allowed to teach because they're the Enlightenment schools of reason, right? Now, no one follows those schools of thought. But in higher ed, you're not allowed to teach about the Judeo-Christian tradition, Judaism, Christianity, Buddhism, Confucianism, and religion. How many people in the audience and in the real world live out those traditions? Just about 7 billion people out of 8 billion, right? And that's why I think we got a fundamental problem. So there's my lecture. Presidents, if you want to weigh in on what has gone wrong in higher ed over the past 20 years, and how can we fix it?
30 seconds.
I wouldn't dare touch that. But what I am willing to touch, until you tell me otherwise, is two things. First, I want to thank you for your passionate defense of the liberal arts, because the liberal arts, which has nothing to do with liberal or conservative, it has to do with its origin, is critically important. And the liberal arts are based on an idea that all ideas need to be discussed. I'd argue with you just a drop in saying that I frankly don't believe the majority of professors on college campuses have taken the view that you've espoused. Unfortunately, some have. From my 40 years in the academy, I've had any number of conversations with parents in which I've said what good faculty members want to do. And I believe in the institutions I've been a part of, almost all of our faculty members are good faculty members. They want to teach your students how to think. And if in the course of that instruction, they think something different at the end than they did at the beginning, that's okay. If they don't think anything different, that's okay, as long as they can articulate either of those beliefs. Very rarely, I believe, do faculty go into a classroom and say, here's what you need to think. You need to learn to think like I think. You need to parrot back what I believe. Yes, that happens, and it happens not very often, but too frequently. Because if it happens at all, it's too frequent. But I don't think that's the norm.
Yeah, I would agree with that. It's interesting, one of your colleagues said a little earlier that actually there's very good working relationships across the aisle here. We don't see it out in public, and I think that's exactly the same phenomenon we're talking about in the university. There's a lot of things that happen in the classroom, in office hours, in seminar rooms that don't get a lot of play, because if it bleeds, it leads, is the way the media treats you and also treats us in academia. As the CEO of the Phi Beta Kappa Society, I would be remiss if I did not thank you for your deep embracement of the liberal arts. Phi Beta Kappa stands for Philosophia Viu Kubernetes, which means love of learning is the guide of life. I mentioned that, Congressman, because it's about the process of the learning, which I think is key. And when we lose track of that, then I think we get ourselves in problems. But the great legal philosopher Alexander Bickel said, the only true integrity is the integrity of process. The process by which we learn in our universities, which is really what we're here talking about today, is what is the glory of our university system in this country.
I want to thank the panel and Mr. Shapiro, your first-rate philosopher on the rise, I can tell. Thank you very much.
Before, I think the gentleman before recognized Ms. Plaskett, I should point out, I've been here a couple hours. If anyone needs still use the restroom or anything, let us know. We can take a short recess, or if you need anything, you got plenty of water and all that. So we'd like to go for a little while longer, and we'll now go to Ms. Plaskett for her questioning.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.